shouldn't have to happen to a little baby.
This woman's child was molested in a case linked to a dial-a-porn telephone call. Hers is but one incident among many. Now the FCC has struck back. Our inside story for Wednesday, November 9th, 1988.
Hi, everybody. I'm John Tesh.
And I'm Mary Hart. The Federal Communications Commission has made its first ever legal move enforcing laws which restrict dial-a-porn telephone calls. The FCC action closes down a California company which provided allegedly obscene telephone messages.
When my kids told me they had called dial-a-porn, my husband and I secretly, like, we laughed. We made up these innocent scenarios of what we thought a dial-a-porn would be on a public phone. We had no idea the contents of it would be anything as vile and as perverted as it were.
Michigan mother Kathleen Matt wrote a complaint to the FCC saying that her 10-year-old daughter had been raped by two friends and her son had molested a 12-year-old girl. The children had first spent $74 in phone charges for 211 minutes of dial-a-porn.
Doctor, it's me. We talk about having sex with animals, dragging women into caves.
And Matt described other dial-a-porn language too lurid for television.
I mean, that's not obscene. It's sick.
The FCC has used federal laws to require the company which recorded those dial-a-porn messages to pay a $50,000 settlement. The commission says it will pursue this material aggressively.
I have ordered our people in the Bureau to call these numbers and to make recommendations to the commission with respect to potential violations, and we will be pursuing them.
But the reaction in Michigan has been cool.
It's a slap on the wrist. It's no punishment. It's, you know, what they did to my family, $50,000, me paying them a couple of pennies.
That hurts to have to look at her sitting on the floor, watching TV, and know that this has happened to her, and it shouldn't have to happen to a little baby.
In Northern California, Paulette Callen's 4-year-old daughter was molested by a boy who got the idea from telephone sex. Many phone services offer call blocking or access codes to restrict dial-a-porn from children. But those victimized claim that isn't enough.
Blocking is not effective. My kids could go across the street and use the neighbor's phone.
The FCC claims it has closed down the dial-a-message operation whose messages the Michigan children heard. However, an attorney for the woman who ran the company tells Entertainment Tonight she is still in the adult message business.
For years, actress Madeline Rue has played roles on television and in the movies where a woman faces a fictional crisis. Now, her biggest fight of all is in real life. Gene Wolfe has a profile.
Madeline Rue has made 10 movies and dozens of TV shows, including Star Trek with Ricardo Montalban.
I'm something of a mystery to them.
No mystery to me.
She's also had a recurring role on Fame, playing an overprotective mother. But on these shows, Madeline was hiding something. In this episode of Days of Our Lives, she had to use a cane and told producers it was only because of an arthritic hip. But today, Madeline Rue openly admits that she's fighting multiple sclerosis, a disease not usually fatal but always debilitating. And she's now learning to walk all over again.
Stand up tall.
I am.
Great.
MS is not a disease you die from. MS is a disease you learn to live with. And it's hard. It's a daily struggle.
These days, Madeline spends a lot of time at home painting, and she cares deeply about what she does. At one point, Madeline wanted to show me a small picture she had painted.
And I can't find it. It has...
It suddenly occurred to Madeline that misplacing that painting, although MS hadn't caused the memory loss, reflected a profound frustration of not being in control of her life.
It's hurt me terribly.
It's hurt you because you think I should know where this is because you're tough on yourself?
Yeah, I'm very tough. It hurts me because it's something I really care about. Now I can't find it. Where the hell have I put it? And how dare I be careless about something that means something to me? And it's hard. And I want to be better than I am and stronger than I am and more thoughtful and more caring and more everything. I just want to be more, bigger, better than I am.
Madeline's first acting job after admitting to the world that she had MS was a recurring role on Houston Nights.
Annie, would you...
Don't try to sweet-talk me.
She also played a judge on L.A. Law.
I feel so loved when I work, and I feel so pretty when I work, and I feel so special when I work. Oh, yeah, it's great.
Madeline also keeps busy with public appearances like this fashion show. And one thing that shows through the pain is her ability to joke with friends about her disability.
God, do I love that dress.
You do? I'm going to rip it off my person and give it to you.
I'd love to wear a ball gown, but it would cut in the wheels, and I'd spend all my time trying to get my dress out of the
wheels. You could make it large enough to cover the whole thing.
Wheelchair.
The whole chair.
Madeline loves to get around town. And to help, she uses a specially equipped van donated by friends. She's even learned how to drive using hand controls.
The truth of the matter is, it's easier to drive with your hands than with your feet.
3 times a week, Madeline Rue must visit Cedars-Sinai Hospital and undergo physical therapy. She works hard at it.
Come on. I can do it.
Madeline Rue truly believes she has a chance of beating the odds and beating MS.
I want to do it now, and I have to remember, it could be a couple of months, it could be a couple of years, but the end result is I'm going to stand and walk.
Gene Wolfe, Entertainment Tonight.
Thank you, Jeannie. Our inside story tomorrow, the worst accident involving an actor since the Twilight Zone tragedy. Actor Michael York says the death of his co-star could have been prevented.
He shouldn't have been doing this shot. We were going too fast.
Death on a movie set, our inside story tomorrow on Entertainment Tonight.
Coming up next, election coverage. Once again, the networks face heat for calling the race early. And ahead, Candace Bergen raises havoc in the newsroom as Murphy Brown.
According to overnight estimates, voting is still more important to Americans than watching the tally on television. Of those who did tune in, the majority watched ABC, followed by NBC. CBS finished last in the ratings. But first in the race to declare a winner, projecting the Bush victory at 9:17 Eastern Time.
Bush wins. Our CBS News estimate is that George Bush will be the next president of the United States.
Critics have said that the modern technology used by the networks in their collection of election data may make voting on the West Coast a waste of time. Nearly 2 hours before the polls across the nation closed, Dan Rather called George Bush's victory. ABC followed 3 minutes later, and NBC, the most cautious, called the race finished an hour and a quarter after CBS. Now, with the attention turned toward George and Barbara Bush, Vanity Fair, the fashion conscience of millions, has said goodbye to the Reagans, and they await the arrival of the 41st president and the fashions of the Bush White House.
I think there will be less of an enshrinement of the new money, high glitz value system, which I think is going to be better in many ways. There really has been such an adulation for the super rich and such an obsession with appearances that I think that the Bush mentality is a lot more down to earth, that it will be a much less tense, taut way of conducting life. And I think we'll miss some of that glamour too.
All three networks will carry coverage of the inauguration on January 20th, with the swearing-in ceremony taking place at 12 noon Eastern Time.
The good news is all those political commercials are now gone from the airwaves. Of course, regular advertising spots will replace them. But maybe American companies should take a lesson from some of the best and most entertaining foreign commercials. A different sort of film festival was held in Cannes, the 35th competition of the world's best television commercials. There were 3,000 entries from 34 countries taking part this year. France, Japan, Brazil, and Britain, all well represented.
If I ate enough Heinz baked beans, do you think I could become Prime Minister?
You just might, Margaret. You just might.
Some of the winning commercials hawked newspapers. Others were for condoms. There were funny ones, sexy ones, and many inventive ones.
My mum packed it. It's my Persil.
Persil Automatic, for everything you wash today.
But But the grand prize winner was this British ad for Volkswagen.
And now, Volkswagen, famous for their great small cars, introduce a great big one.
The contest is co-sponsored by Adweek magazine. A special benefit screening of the winning commercials will take place in Los Angeles this evening.
The Cosby Show is suffering through some contractual obligations. No, not of the legal variety. The Huxtable's daughter is about to present the family with a special delivery.
Oh!
What?
Oh, I need to lie down.
No, just let her lie down.
For Sabrina LaBeouf and Jeffrey Owens, better known to millions of viewers of The Cosby Show as Sandra and Elvin, tomorrow night is the big event. They're going to make Dr. Huxtable a first-time granddad.
Something very emotional, and to watch two people go through that. And then, so the audience was right there with us, which is terrific. And then Bill came up to me and he says, I see you were in your milieu there. I said, yes, suffering and pain.
Time.
10 minutes, 38 seconds.
All right.
Contraction. This time, the car, the hospital, my father.
Elvin is completely calm and composed during the
I just don't wrestle with
thing.
Anything. I'm just the picture of health and composure.
I will call Dr. Taylor and get everything all set
yes,
up, all right?
Yes, I agree.
Oh, but Dad, now remember, you promised Ellen and I no special treatment at the hospital.
Okay, fine. I'll just have them set up a tent out in the parking lot.
The special one-hour episode of The Cosby Show airs tomorrow night on NBC.
Candace Bergen is coming to primetime series television. She plays Murphy Brown, a reporter who lives for her work and whose personal life is duller than dishwater. But it's that dishwater which Bergen hopes will make Murphy Brown funny.
Hi, everybody.
Candace Bergen is having the time of her life playing television journalist Murphy Brown.
The reason I decided to do a series was because it was a comedy. Because what I've always wanted to do and what I always felt most comfortable doing was comedy.
What you want?
And Murphy Brown is a comedy that Bergen believes today's career woman will relate to.
She doesn't have a life. She has a spectacular career, but she has no home life. She has no romantic life. Her plants are dead. She can't get her painter on the phone.
Oh, come on, Mr. Secretary. You're not backing out on me, are you? Look, we can pre-tape in the morning and I'll have you on a plane to Helsinki in the afternoon. Come on. I'll do my Ted Koppel impression. Excuse me, a very urgent call just came in. I'm going to have to get back to you. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Eldon Bernicke? Okay. You were supposed to show up to paint the inside of my house 2 weeks ago.
But the character of Murphy Brown is closer to Bergen's real life than many of us would guess.
They offered me the job as one of the correspondents early on in 60 Minutes, and I just wasn't ready to do something like that full time. Of course, now I could kill myself that I turned it down, except if I had done it, then I wouldn't have been able to parody it on Murphy Brown.
Let's start with the question everyone's asking. Did you sleep with Gwen Lansing or not?
Well, I love it, because it's really what I almost did if I hadn't gone into acting. So for me to get to do comedy and play someone who's a television journalist, it's really as close as I could get to heaven.
Murphy Brown premieres Monday night on CBS.
As the baby boom generation matures into parenthood, baby movies are doing booming business. But if you're stuck at home with a kid, which occasionally happens to Lenny Malton, he has a way to enjoy those movies from the comfort of your living room. Leonard.
How'd you know that, John? Well, one of the year's hottest movies is coming to video stores this coming week, Three Men and a Baby. There's no question that the real-life baby boom has something to do with the number of babies who are turning up on the screen these days. In fact, Diane Keaton starred in a funny movie called Baby Boom. But as usual, I found a number of movies, old and new, that put babies in the spotlight. They're all available on home video, including this newest entry in the baby sweepstakes.
That's a baby.
Oh, I know, it's a baby. What's it doing there?
It's changing the lives of three swinging bachelors. That's what it's doing in Three Men and a Baby. Watching Tom Selleck, Steve Guttenberg, and Ted Danson gradually give their lives over to this adorable toddler is the kind of comedy that I'd call surefire.
Good night, sweetheart. Good night.
Here's another comedy that I'd call rapid fire.
Raising Arizona is all about a childless couple, played by Nicolas Cage and Holly Hunter, who solve their problem by kidnapping one of a rich couple's quintuplets. Sounds bizarre, I know, but it's frantic and funny. Here the oddball pair introduce Nathan Jr. to his new home.
And this here's the divan for socializing and relaxing with the family unit.
Working girl Ginger Rogers inherits a baby that isn't hers through a comedy of errors in Bachelor Mother. The problem is, she can't convince anyone it doesn't belong to her. Pretty soon, she stops trying.
Where did it come from?
I got it for Christmas.
David Niven plays Ginger's boss, and Charles Coburn plays Niven's father, who comes to believe that the baby is really his grandson in this very cute comedy. There's another wide-eyed babe who legitimately belongs to Carol Lombard and Jimmy Stewart in Made for Each Other. This movie gets a bit soggy with soap opera plotting, but you can't go wrong with a cute kid and two wonderful stars like that.
Hey, Mother. Mother, come here. Jane, look. He's smiling at me. He's smiling at me.
That's gas.
Finally, there's this unforgettable number from the MGM musical, The Bandwagon, with Fred Astaire, Nanette Fabre, and Jack Buchanan as the screen's most talented and possibly most ornery triplets.
Oh, we do everything alike. We look alike. We dress alike. We walk alike. We talk alike. And what is more, we hate each other very much. We hate our folks. We're sick of jokes on what an art it is to tell them apart.
One of my favorite numbers. Incidentally, I would have recommended the original French version of Three Men and a Baby, which is called Three Men in a Cradle, but the version that's out on home video is dubbed into English, and I think it loses the French flavor that gave it its charm in the first place. I guess what I'm saying is, buy American.
It's funny stuff, Leonard. Thank you.
Thanks, Leonard.
When we come back, President Reagan gets all the coverage in England on election night. The Insider will tell us why.
Air transportation furnished and a promotional fee paid by Delta Airlines. Delta is first in passenger satisfaction of all major U.S. airlines. At Delta, we love to fly and it shows. Celebrating a birthday today, actor Lou Ferrigno is 37. Mary Travers of Peter, Paul and Mary is 51. And actress Hedy Lamarr is 75.
While the ET Insider and other loyal Americans were watching election returns on television last night, much of Great Britain was tuned into the movies that made our current White House resident famous. England's Channel 4 broadcast a retrospective of Ronald Reagan movies, Desperate Journey, Dark Victory, and of course, Bedtime for Bonzo. Among the Brits not tuned in, though, a rock fan named Eamon Hagen. Hagen's neighbors have complained loud and long about his habit of playing Michael Jackson records at full blast on the stereo and singing along. According to one neighbor, it's a nightmare. The whole house shakes and vibrates. Reporters went to the house to check out the story. Hagen slammed the door, turned up the music, and shouted, "Get stuffed and leave me alone." The insider's kind of guy.
Hollywood has been complaining for years about losing movie and television production to locations outside of California. Now one of its main tourist attractions has turned up clear across the country in Florida.
In Florida, at the Disney MGM complex, actor-director Jackie Cooper took part in an old tradition at the site where a replica of Hollywood's famed Chinese theater is under construction.
It's just a marvelous, exciting experience, and it's going to grow and grow and grow real fast here.
In Kansas, Yoko Ono unveiled her first major art show since 1972. The six-week exhibit features conceptual, sort of interactive works, like this broken cup, which the public gets to glue back together. And this piece called Nail It, a large white background and a bucket of nails, which patrons are encouraged to hammer. And in Beverly Hills, the topic was stars as producers at the monthly newsmaker luncheon of the Hollywood Radio and Television Society. Henry Winkler was joined on a panel by actor-producer Marlo Thomas and Ted Danson, who recalls his first dual role project.
It was terrifying. I'd never been, you know, actors kind of walk around in this special little protective glow. I've never been so overwhelmed by all of the compromises you have to make.
I got a couple of questions about that Yoko Ono deal.
Oh, that art?
Maybe later. Vanna White, the lady that spins the Wheel of Fortune, has a spin-off in her career. Tomorrow she'll tell us about her TV movie role as the Goddess of Love.
Speaking of goddesses, there is another who has a new song about to hit the...